To the Queen's advisers, she must seem the ultimate insider trader, as, thanks to her royal boxes, she's ahead of the game, having advanced knowledge of any country's ups and downs, useful, as in racing, to those buying and selling. On the Queen's accession, it was said she was worth 300 million. Now, the royal nest egg's said to be 17 billion. Her investments in BP and in Rio Tinto Zinc mean, very simply, she profits from petrol and uranium, and her subjects get ill. After the Queen had been the first person to switch on nuclear power at Calder Hall in Cumbria in the 1950s, the world's first nuclear power station was followed by Sizewell B, and the Queen was advised to invest in uranium. Notwithstanding any greenwash, royal gamblers have few ethics, and, despite a feigned concern, royalty knows that arms are good investments, and since those with money like making more, they risk the Earth's transformation into a Death Star, through shells and bombs and cruise missiles, all tipped with depleted uranium, so they pierce more easily through the heavy armour and the fortifications of perceived enemies. Air, water and soil are contaminated when DU is used. Dr. Doug Roki, the ex-director of the Pentagon's depleted uranium project, says there is no way to decontaminate an area hit with uranium.
We also know it happens forever. Therefore, when the Army personally says that food and water will be contaminated, and that's an indiscriminate killer, that makes the use of depleted uranium a crime against God and a crime against humanity.
A large part of the baby boom generation had their immune systems compromised at birth.
Dr. Jay Gould would reveal in his book, The Enemy Within, the extent of royalties' uranium investments. And their uranium wealth was hothoused by an entrepreneur, Tiny Rowland, thanks to Rowland's companies, Lonro and Rio Tinto. Tiny Rowland asset stripped half of Africa, and though this takeover bidder for Harrods was called the unpleasant and unacceptable face of capitalism, he was popular with the royals and the mega rich.
And Tiny Rowland says he loves Africa. Because Africa has enriched him, so he would love it. He definitely loves it because it has enriched him. The relationship between Tiny Rowland and African presidents is not really sincere and honest. It's the relationship between the rider and the horse. It's the rider who benefits. I don't think the horse benefited at all.
Anything that has been brought to light as a result of the Lonro affair, do you find any of that in any way the unacceptable face of capitalism?
I can't judge, because this has now escalated into a political matter, and I know so little about politics here that I just can't comment.
Never mind that Roland was formerly Roland Walter Fürop, an unashamed member of Hitler Youth. Princess Alexandra's husband, the Queen's nephew, Angus Ogilvy, would sit on Roland's board with royal approval. The royal shares would thus finance the arming of Africa in Lonro's resource wars. African leaders, who promised Lonro their strategic minerals, were armed to the hilt by Ogilvy and Rowland. Tiny Rowland was nicknamed the Royals' Buccaneer, and how much he made them is unknown. But the conditions of his African workforces were notorious, and so Africa fueled new spurts of royal wealth. The Anti-Slavery Society reported in 1987 that in Lonro's Ashanti gold mines, 60 boys had to work almost naked in a pool of cyanide at Lonro's extractor plant in Ghana. The cyanide, used in separating out the gold, enters the body as gas, liquid, or acid dust. The boys worked naked, since, on Roland's orders, this was company policy to reduce theft. In 1973, Lonro was the biggest plantation owner in Africa, controlling 98% of oil imports through its pipelines. It mined, for example, 40% of Zimbabwe's gold, and it was the largest agricultural producer. Thus, thanks to their pet buccaneer, the royal shareholders were recolonizing Africa by the back door. And thus, thanks to Tiny Roland's advice, their uranium holdings are now worth more than $6 billion. But just as England, that was wont to conquer others, as Shakespeare wrote, hath made a shameful conquest of herself, a uranium wind can now blow back into the faces of these profiteers, with their poisons being impossible to decontaminate. Thanks to uranium investors, radioactive isotopes are now found in the flesh of worms. At a Ministry of Defence weapons range in Dumfries, depleted uranium has turned the worms mutant. Worms are a pillar of ecosystems through aerating the soil and aiding the nutrient uptake of plants, whom Charles reputedly likes to talk to, though he may now need a Geiger counter before addressing his radioactive triffids in Scotland. However, there'll be no apology from the palace for any carcinogenic carnage, since DU, hardening the tips of shells to pierce concrete, is one of Royal Ordnance's star exports. Despite Royal Ordnance weapons that contain DU, such as those made at Fazakerley, Liverpool, counting as poison gas weapons, violating the Geneva Convention under the 1925 Geneva Poison Gas Protocol. The DU shell, which the sovereign has shares in, is a highly mobile, indiscriminate killer. It's described as a permanent terrain contaminant, which has a half-life of 4.5 billion years. Unlike any hereditary monarchy, however historic, DU stains the environment forever and ever. Its half-life has earned it the title of a silent killer. The silent killer that will never stop killing. And there's nothing depleted about depleted uranium when you see the birth defects it causes. Swollen heads, enlarged eyeballs, dysfunctional limbs. As DU rewrites DNA codes, making them into nonsense.
What this has generated is from 2004 up to this day, we are seeing a rate of congenital malformations in the city of Fallujah that is surpassed even that in the aftermath of, in the wake of the Japanese cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki that were, that nuclear bombs were dropped on at the end of World War II.
While the British government was waging its illegal war in Iraq, it increased the value of the royal investment. For the price of uranium would rise 500% in 6 years. Its radioactive death dance turns a royal profit.